Mockingjay, Disc 10. Eventually, I'm released from the hospital and given a room in the president's mansion to share with my mother. She's almost never there, taking her meals and sleeping at work. It falls to Hamish to check on me, make sure I'm eating and using my medicines. It's not an easy job. I take to my old habits from District 13, wandering unauthorized through the mansion, into bedrooms and offices, ballrooms and baths, seeking strange little hiding spaces, a closet of furs, a cabinet in the library, a long-forgotten bathtub in a room of discarded furniture. My places are dim and quiet and impossible to find. I curl up, make myself smaller, try to disappear entirely. Wrapped in silence, I slide my bracelet that reads, mentally disoriented, around and around my wrist. My name is Katniss Everdeen. I'm 17 years old. My home is District 12. There is no District 12. I am the Mockingjay. I brought down the Capitol. President Snow hates me. He killed my sister. Now I will kill him. And then the Hunger Games will be over. Periodically, I find myself back in my room, unsure whether I was driven by a need for morphling or if Hamish ferreted me out. I eat the food, take the medicine, and am required to bathe. It's not the water I mind, but the mirror that reflects my naked fire-mutt body. The skin grafts still retain a newborn baby pinkness. The skin deemed damaged, but salvageable, looks red, hot, and melted in places. Patches of my former self gleam white and pale. I'm like a bizarre patchwork quilt of skin. Parts of my hair were singed off completely. The rest has been chopped off at odd lengths. Katniss Everdeen, the girl who was on fire. I wouldn't much care, except the sight of my body brings back the memory of the pain, and why I was in pain, and what happened just before the pain started, and how I watched my little sister become a human torch. Closing my eyes doesn't help. Fire burns brighter in the darkness. Dr. Aurelius shows up sometimes. I like him because he doesn't say stupid things like how I'm totally safe, or that he knows I can't see it, but I'll be happy again one day, or even that things will be better in Panem now. He just asks if I feel like talking, and when I don't answer, he falls asleep in his chair. In fact, I think his visits are largely motivated by his need for a nap. The arrangement works for both of us. The time draws near, although I could not give you exact hours and minutes. President Snow has been tried and found guilty, sentenced to execution, Hamish tells me. I hear talk of it as I drift past the guards in the hallways. My Mockingjay suit arrives in my room. Also my bow, looking no worse for wear, but no sheath of arrows, either because they were damaged, or more likely, because I shouldn't have weapons. I vaguely wonder if I should be preparing for the event in some way, but nothing comes to mind. Late one afternoon, after a long period in a cushioned window seat behind a painted screen, I emerge and turn left instead of right. I find myself in a strange part of the mansion and immediately lose my bearings. Unlike the area where I'm quartered, there seems to be no one around to ask. I like it, though. Wish I'd found it sooner. It's so quiet, with the thick carpets and heavy tapestries soaking up the sound. Softly lit, muted colors, peaceful. Until I smell the roses. I dive behind some curtains, shaking too hard to run, while I await the mats. Finally, I realize there are no mutts coming. So, what do I smell? Real roses? Could it be that I am near the garden where the evil things grow? As I creep down the hall, the odor becomes overpowering. Perhaps not as strong as the actual mutts, but purer, because it's not competing with sewage and explosives. I turn a corner and find myself staring at two surprised guards. Not peacekeepers, of course. There are no more peacekeepers. But not the trim, gray-uniformed soldiers from 13, either. These two, a man and a woman, wear the tattered, thrown-together clothes of actual rebels. Still bandaged and gaunt, they are now keeping watch over the doorway to the roses. When I move to enter, their guns form an X in front of me.
"You can't go in, miss," says the man.
"Soldier," the woman corrects him.
"You can't go in, Soldier Everdeen. President's orders."
I just stand there patiently waiting for them to lower their guns, for them to understand, without my telling them, that behind those doors is something I need. Just a rose, a single bloom, to place in Snow's lapel before I shoot him. My presence seems to worry the guards. They're discussing calling Haymitch when a woman speaks up behind me.
"Let her go in."
I know the voice, but can't immediately place it. Not Seam, not 13, definitely not Capital. I turn my head and find myself face to face with Paler, the commander from 8. She looks even more beat up than she did at the hospital. But who doesn't?
"On my authority," says Paler,
"she has a right to anything behind that door." These are her soldiers, not coins. They drop their weapons without question and let me pass. At the end of a short hallway, I push apart the glass doors and step inside. By now, the smell's so strong that it begins to flatten out, as if there's no more my nose can absorb. The damp, mild air feels good on my hot skin, and the roses are glorious. Row after row of sumptuous blooms in lush pink, sunset orange, and even pale blue. I wander through the aisles of carefully pruned plants, looking but not touching, because I have learned the hard way how deadly these beauties can be. I know when I find it, crowning the top of a slender bush, a magnificent white bud just beginning to open. I pull my left sleeve over my hand so that my skin won't actually have to touch it, take up a pair of pruning shears, and have just positioned them on the stem when he speaks.
"That's a nice one."
My hand jerks. The shears snap shut, severing the stem. The colors are lovely, of course, but nothing says perfection like white. I still can't see him, but his voice seems to rise up from an adjacent bed of red roses. Delicately pinching the stem of the bud through the fabric of my sleeve, I move slowly around the corner and find him sitting on a stool against the wall. He's as well-groomed and finely dressed as ever, but weighted down with manacles, ankle shackles, tracking devices. In the bright light, his skin's a pale, sickly green. He holds a white handkerchief spotted with fresh blood. Even in his deteriorated state, his snake eyes shine bright and cold.
"I was hoping you'd find your way to my quarters."
His quarters? I have trespassed into his home, the way he slithered into mine last year, hissing threats with his bloody, rosy breath. This greenhouse is one of his rooms, perhaps his favorite, perhaps in better times he tended the plants himself, but now it's part of his prison. That's why the guards halted me, and that's why Paler let me in. I'd supposed he would be secured in the deepest dungeon that the capital had to offer, not cradled in the lap of luxury. Yet Coin left him here, to set a precedent, I guess, so that if in the future she ever fell from grace, it would be understood that presidents, even the most despicable, get special treatment. Who knows, after all, when her own power might fade? There are so many things we should discuss, but I have a feeling your visit will be brief. So, first things first. He begins to cough, and when he removes the handkerchief from his mouth, it's redder. I wanted to tell you how very sorry I am about your sister. Even in my deadened, drugged condition, this sends a stab of pain through me, reminding me that there are no limits to his cruelty, and how he will go to his grave trying to destroy me. So wasteful, so unnecessary. Anyone could see the game was over by that point. In fact, I was just about to issue an official surrender when they released those parachutes. His eyes are glued on me, unblinking, so as not to miss a second of my reaction. But what he's said makes no sense. When they released the parachutes... Well, you really didn't think I gave the order, did you? Forget the obvious fact that if I'd had a working hovercraft at my disposal, I'd have been using it to make an escape. But that aside, what purpose could it have served? We both know I'm not above killing children, but I'm not wasteful. I take life for very specific reasons, and there was no reason for me to destroy a pen full of capital children. None at all. I wonder if the next fit of coughing is staged so that I can have time to absorb his words. He's lying. Of course he's lying. But there's something struggling to free itself from the lie as well. However, I must concede it was a masterful move on Coin's part. The idea that I was bombing our own helpless children instantly snapped whatever frail allegiance my people still felt to me. There was no real resistance after that. Did you know it aired live? You can see Plutarch's hand there, and in the parachutes. Well, it's that sort of thinking that you look for in a head game maker, isn't it? Snow dabs the corners of his mouth. I'm sure he wasn't gunning for your sister, but these things happen. I'm not with Snow now. I'm in special weaponry, back in 13 with Gale and Beatty, looking at the designs based on Gale's traps that played on human sympathies. The first bomb killed the victims, the second, the rescuers. Remembering Gale's words, Beatty and I have been following the same rulebook President Snow used when he hijacked PETA. My failure, says Snow, was being so slow to grasp Coin's plan. To let the capital and districts destroy one another and then... step in to take power with 13 barely scratched. Make no mistake, she was intending to take my place right from the beginning. I shouldn't be surprised. After all, it was 13 that started the rebellion that led to the dark days, and then abandoned the rest of the districts when the tide turned against it. But I wasn't watching Coin. I was watching you, Mockingjay. And you were watching me. I'm afraid we have both been played for fools. I refuse for this to be true. Some things even I can't survive. I utter my first words since my sister's death. I don't believe you. Snow shakes his head in mock disappointment. Oh,
My dear Miss Everdeen, I thought we had agreed not to lie to each other. Chapter 26. Out in the hall, I find Paler standing in exactly the same spot.
Did you find what you were looking for? She asks.
I hold up the white bud in answer, and then stumble past her. I must have made it back to my room, because the next thing I know, I'm filling a glass with water from the bathroom faucet and sticking the rose in it. I sink to my knees on the cold tile and squint at the flower, as the whiteness seems hard to focus on in the stark fluorescent light. My finger catches the inside of my bracelet, twisting it like a tourniquet, hurting my wrist. I'm hoping the pain will help me hang on to reality the way it did for Peter. I must hang on. I must know the truth about what has happened. There are two possibilities, although the details associated with them may vary. First, as I believed, that the Capitol sent in that hovercraft, dropped the parachutes, and sacrificed their children's lives, knowing the recently arrived rebels would go to their aid. There's evidence to support this, the Capitol's seal on the hovercraft, the lack of any attempt to blow the enemy out of the sky, and their long history of using children as pawns in their battle against the districts. Then there's Snow's account, that a Capitol hovercraft, manned by rebels, bombed the children to bring a speedy end to the war. But if this was the case, why didn't the Capitol fire on the enemy? Did the element of surprise throw them? Had they no defenses left? Children are precious to 13, or so it has always seemed. Well, not me, maybe. Once I had outlived my usefulness, I was expendable, although I think it's been a long time since I've been considered a child in this war. And why would they do it, knowing their own medics would likely respond and be taken out by the second blast? They wouldn't. They couldn't. Snow's lying, manipulating me as he always has, hoping to turn me against the rebels and possibly destroy them. Yes, of course. Then what's nagging at me? Those double exploding bombs, for one. It's not that the Capitol couldn't have the same weapon. It's just that I'm sure the rebels did. Gale and Beatty's brainchild. Then there's the fact that Snow made no escape attempt, when I know him to be the consummate survivor. It seems hard to believe he didn't have a retreat somewhere, some bunker stocked with provisions where he could live out the rest of his snaky little life. And finally, there's his assessment of Coin. What's irrefutable is that she's done exactly what he said. Let the Capitol and the districts run one another into the ground, and then sauntered in to take power. Even if that was her plan, it doesn't mean she dropped those parachutes. Victory was already in her grasp. Everything was in her grasp. Except me. I recall Boggs's response when I admitted I hadn't put much thought into Snow's successor.
If your immediate answer isn't Coin, then you're a threat. You're the face of the rebellion. You may have more influence than any other single person. Outwardly, the most you've ever done is tolerated her.
Suddenly I'm thinking of Prim, who was not yet 14, not yet old enough to be granted the title of soldier, but somehow working on the front lines. How did such a thing happen?
That my sister would have wanted to be there, I have no doubt. That she would be more capable than many older than she is a given. But for all that, someone very high up would have had to approve putting a 13-year-old in combat. Did Coin do it, hoping that losing Prim would push me completely over the edge? Or at least, firmly on her side? I wouldn't even have had to witness it in person. Numerous cameras would be covering the city circle, capturing the moment forever. No, now I am going crazy, slipping into some state of paranoia. Too many people would know of the mission. Word would get out. Or would it? Who would have to know, besides Coin, Plutarch, and a small, loyal, or easily disposable crew? I badly need help working this out. Only everyone I trust is dead. Cinna, Boggs, Finnick, Prim. There's Peter, but he couldn't do any more than speculate. And who knows what state his mind's in, anyway. And that leaves only Gale. He's far away. But even if he were beside me, could I confide in him? What could I say? How could I phrase it without implying that it was his bomb that killed Prim? The impossibility of that idea, more than any, is why Snow must be lying. Ultimately, there's only one person to turn to who might know what happened and might still be on my side. To broach the subject at all will be a risk, but while I think Haymitch might gamble with my life in the arena, I don't think he'd rat me out to Coin. Whatever problems we may have with each other, we prefer resolving our differences one-on-one. I scramble off the tiles, out the door, and across the hall to his room. When there's no response to my knock, I push inside. Ugh! It's amazing how quickly he can defile a space. Half-eaten plates of food, shattered liquor bottles, and pieces of broken furniture from a drunken rampage scatter his quarters. He lies, unkempt and unwashed, in a tangle of sheets on the bed, passed out. Haymitch, I say, shaking his leg. Of course, that's insufficient. But I give it a few more tries before I dump the pitcher of water in his face. He comes to with a gasp, slashing blindly with his knife. Apparently, the end of Snow's reign didn't equal the end of his terror. Oh, you, he says. I can tell by his voice that he's still loaded. Haymitch, I begin. Listen to that. The Mockingjay found her voice. He laughs. Well, Plutarch's going to be happy. He takes a swig from a bottle. Why am I soaking wet? I lamely drop the pitcher behind me into a pile of dirty clothes. I need your help, I say. Haymitch belches, filling the air with white liquor fumes. What is it, sweetheart? More boy trouble? I don't know why, but this hurts me in a way Haymitch rarely can. It must show on my face, because even in his drunken state, he tries to take it back. Okay, not funny. I'm already at the door. Not funny! Come back! By the thud of his body hitting the floor, I assume he tried to follow me, but there's no point. I zigzag through the mansion and disappear into a wardrobe full of silken things. I yank them from hangers until I have a pile, and then burrow into it. In the lining of my pocket, I find a stray morphling tablet and swallow it dry, heading off my rising hysteria. It's not enough to write things, though. I hear Haymitch calling me in the distance, but he won't find me in his condition, especially not in this new spot. Swathed in silk, I feel like a caterpillar in a cocoon awaiting metamorphosis. I always supposed that to be a peaceful condition. At first it is, but as I journey into night, I feel more and more trapped, suffocated by the slippery bindings, unable to emerge until I have transformed into something of beauty. I squirm, trying to shed my ruined body and unlock the secret to growing flawless wings. Despite enormous effort, I remain a hideous creature, fired into my current form by the blast from the bombs. The encounter with Snow opens the door to my old repertoire of nightmares. It's like being stung by crackerjackers again. A wave of horrifying images with a brief respite I confuse with waking, only to find another wave knocking me back. When the guards finally locate me, I'm sitting on the floor of the wardrobe, tangled in silk, screaming my head off. I fight them at first, until they convince me they're trying to help, peel away the choking garments, and escort me back to my room. On the way, we pass a window, and I see a gray, snowy dawn spreading across the capital. A very hungover Haymitch waits with a handful of pills and a tray of food that neither of us has the stomach for. He makes a feeble attempt to get me to talk again, but seeing it's pointless, sends me to a bath someone has drawn. The tub's deep, with three steps to the bottom. I ease down into the warm water and sit, up to my neck in suds, hoping the medicines kick in soon. My eyes focus on the rose that has spread its petals overnight, filling the steamy air with its strong perfume. I rise and reach for a towel to smother it, when there's a tentative knock and the bathroom door opens, revealing three familiar faces. They try to smile at me, but even Venia can't conceal her shock at my ravaged mutt body. "Surprise!" Octavia squeaks, and then bursts into tears. I'm puzzling over their reappearance when I realize that this must be it, the day of the execution. They've come to prep me for the cameras, remake me to Beauty Base Zero. No wonder Octavia's crying. It's an impossible task. They can barely touch my patchwork of skin for fear of hurting me, so I rinse and dry off myself. I tell them I hardly notice the pain anymore, but Flavia still winces as he drapes a robe around me. In the bedroom, I find another surprise. Sitting upright in a chair, polished from her metallic gold wig to her patent leather high heels, gripping a clipboard. Remarkably unchanged, except for the vacant look in her eyes. "Effie," I say.
"Hello, Katniss."
She stands and kisses me on the cheek, as if nothing has occurred since our last meeting, the night before the Quarter Quell.
"Well, it looks like we've got another big, big, big day ahead of us. So why don't you start your prep and I'll just pop over and check on the arrangements."
"Okay," I say to her back. "They say Plutarch and Haymitch had a hard time keeping her alive," comments Venia under her breath. "She was imprisoned after your escape, so that helps."
"It's quite a stretch. Effie Trinket, rebel. But I don't want Coin killing her, so I make a mental note to present her that way if asked. I guess it's good Plutarch kidnapped you three after all.
We're the only prep team still alive, and all the stylists from the Quarter Quell are dead," says Venia. She doesn't say who specifically killed them. I'm beginning to wonder if it matters. She gingerly takes one of my scarred hands and holds it out for inspection. "Now, what do you think for the nails? Red, or maybe a jet black?" Flavius performs some beauty miracle on my hair, managing to even out the front while getting some of the longer locks to hide the bald spots in the back. My face, since it was spared from the flames, presents no more than the usual challenges. Once I'm in Cinna's Mockingjay suit, the only scars visible are on my neck, forearms, and hands. Octavia secures my Mockingjay pin over my heart, and we step back to look in the mirror. I can't believe how normal they've made me look on the outside when inwardly I'm such a wasteland. There's a tap at the door, and Gale steps in.
"Can I have a minute?" he asks.
In the mirror, I watch my prep team, Unsure of where to go, they bump into one another a few times, and then closet themselves in the bathroom. Gail comes up behind me, and we examine each other's reflection. I'm searching for something to hang on to, some sign of the girl and boy who met by chance in the woods 5 years ago and became inseparable. I'm wondering what would have happened to them if the Hunger Games had not reaped the girl. If she would have fallen in love with the boy, married him even. And sometime in the future, when the brothers and sisters had been raised up, escaped with him into the woods and left 12 behind forever. Would they have been happy out in the wild, or would the dark, twisted sadness between them have grown up even without the capital's help?
I brought you this.
Gail holds up a sheath. When I take it, I notice it holds a single ordinary arrow.
It's supposed to be symbolic. You firing the last shot of the war.
What if I miss? I say. Does Coin retrieve it and bring it back to me? Or just shoot Snow through the head herself?
You won't miss.
Gail adjusts the sheath on my shoulder. We stand there, face to face, not meeting each other's eyes. You didn't come see me in the hospital. He doesn't answer, so finally I just say it. Was it your bomb?
I don't know. Neither does Beatty, he says. Does it matter? You'll always be thinking about it.
He waits for me to deny it. I want to deny it, but it's true. Even now I can see the flash that ignites her, feel the heat of the flames, and I will never be able to separate that moment from Gail. My silence is my answer.
That was the one thing I had going for me, taking care of your family, he says.
Shoot straight. Okay. He touches my cheek and leaves. I want to call him back and tell him that I was wrong, that I'll figure out a way to make peace with this, to remember the circumstances under which he created the bomb, take into account my own inexcusable crimes, dig up the truth about who dropped the parachutes, prove it wasn't the rebels, forgive him. But since I can't, I'll just have to deal with the pain. Effie comes in to usher me to some kind of meeting. I collect my bow, and at the last minute remember the rose glistening in its glass of water. When I open the door to the bathroom, I find my prep team sitting in a row on the edge of the tub, hunched and defeated. I remember I'm not the only one whose world has been stripped away. Come on, I tell them. We've got an audience waiting. I'm expecting a production meeting in which Plutarch instructs me where to stand and gives me my cue for shooting Snow. Instead, I find myself sent into a room where 6 people sit around a table. Peeta, Joanna, Beatty, Haymitch, Annie, and Inobaria. They all wear the gray rebel uniforms from 13. No one looks particularly well. What's this? I say.
We're not sure, Haymitch answers. It appears to be a gathering of the remaining victors.
We're all that's left? I ask.
The price of celebrity, says Beatty. We were targeted from both sides.
The capital killed the victors they suspected of being rebels. The rebels killed those thought to be allied with the capital.
Joanna scowls at Inobaria.
So what's she doing here?
She is protected under what we call the Mockingjay deal, says Coin as she enters behind me,
wherein Katniss Everdeen agreed to support the rebels in exchange for captured victor's immunity. Katniss has upheld her side of the bargain, and so shall we.
Inobaria smiles at Joanna.
Don't look so smug, says Joanna. We'll kill you anyway.
Sit down, please, Katniss, says Coin, closing the door. I take a seat between Annie and Beatty, carefully placing Snow's rose on the table. As usual, Coin gets right to the point.
I've asked you here to settle a debate. Today we will execute Snow. In the previous weeks, hundreds of his accomplices in the oppression of Panem have been tried and now await their own deaths. However, the suffering in the districts has been so extreme that these measures appear insufficient to the victims. In fact, many are calling for a complete annihilation of those who held capital citizenry. However, in the interest of maintaining a sustainable population, we cannot afford this. Through the water in the glass, I see a distorted image of one of Peeta's hands, the burn marks. We are both fire mutts now. My eyes travel up to where the flames licked across his forehead, singeing away his brows, but just missing his eyes. Those same blue eyes that used to meet mine and then flit away at school, just as they do now. So, an alternative has been placed on the table. Since my colleagues and I can come to no consensus, it has been agreed that we will let the victors decide. A majority of four will approve the plan. No one may abstain from the vote, says Coin. What has been proposed is that in lieu of eliminating the entire capital population, we have a final symbolic Hunger Games, using the children directly related to those who held the most power. All seven of us turn to her. What? Says Joanna. We hold another Hunger Games using capital children, says Coin. Are you joking? Asks Peeta. No, I should also tell you that if we do hold the games, it will be known it was done with your approval, although the individual breakdown of your votes will be kept secret for your own security, Coin tells us. Was this Plutarch's idea? Asks Haymitch. It was mine, says Coin. It seemed to balance the need for vengeance with the least loss of life. You may cast your votes.
No, bursts out Peeta. I vote no, of course. We can't have another Hunger Games.
Why not? Joanna retorts. It seems very fair to me. Snow even has a granddaughter. I vote yes.
So do I, says Inobaria, almost indifferently. Let them have a taste of their own medicine.
This is why we rebelled, remember?
Peeta looks at the rest of us.
Annie?
I vote no with Peeta, she says. So would Finnick if he were here.
But he isn't, because Snow's mutts killed him, Joanna reminds her.
No, says Beatty. It would set a bad precedent. We have to stop viewing one another as enemies. At this point, unity is essential for our survival. No.
We're down to Katniss and Haymitch, says Coin.
Was it like this then, 75 years or so ago? Did a group of people sit around and cast their votes on initiating the Hunger Games? Was there dissent? Did someone make a case for mercy that was beaten down by the calls for the deaths of the district's children? The scent of Snow's rose curls up into my nose, down into my throat, squeezing it tight with despair. All those people I loved, dead, and we are discussing the next Hunger Games in an attempt to avoid wasting life? Nothing has changed. Nothing will ever change now.
I weigh my options carefully, think everything through, keeping my eyes on the rose. I say,
I vote yes for Prim.
Haymitch, it's up to you, says Coin. A furious Peeta
hammers Haymitch with the atrocity he could become party to, but I can feel Haymitch watching me. This is the moment, then, when we find out exactly just how alike we are, and how much he truly understands me. I'm with the Mockingjay, he says.
Excellent! That carries the vote, says Coyne. Now, we really must take our places for the execution.
As she passes me, I hold up the glass with the rose.
Can you see that Snow's wearing this?
Just over his heart.
Coyne smiles.
Of course, and I'll make sure he knows about the games.
Thank you, I say. People sweep into the room, surround me. The last touch of powder, the instructions from Plutarch as I'm guided to the front doors of the mansion. The city circle runs over, spills people down the side streets. The others take their places outside, guards, officials, rebel leaders, victors. I hear the cheers that indicate Coyne has appeared on the balcony. Then Effie taps my shoulder, and I step out into the cold winter sunlight, walk to my position, accompanied by the deafening roar of the crowd. As directed, I turn so they see me in profile and wait. When they march Snow out the door, the audience goes insane. They secure his hands behind a post, which is unnecessary. He's not going anywhere. There's nowhere to go. This is not the roomy stage before the training center, but the narrow terrace in front of the president's mansion. No wonder no one bothered to have me practice. He's 10 yards away. I feel the bow purring in my hand, reach back and grasp the arrow, position it, aim at the rose, but watch his face. He coughs, and a bloody dribble runs down his chin. His tongue flicks over his puffy lips. I search his eyes for the slightest sign of anything, fear, remorse, anger. But there's only the same look of amusement that ended our last conversation. It's as if he's speaking the words again.
Oh, my dear Miss Everdeen, I thought we had agreed not to lie to each other.
He's right.
We did.
The point of my arrow shifts upward. I release the string, and President Coyne collapses over the side of the balcony and plunges to the ground, dead.
Chapter 27. In the stunned reaction that follows, I'm aware of one sound. Snow's laughter, an awful gurgling cackle accompanied by an eruption of foamy blood when the coughing begins. I see him bend forward, spewing out his life until the guards block him from my sight. As the gray uniforms begin to converge on me, I think of what my brief future as the assassin of Panem's new president holds, the interrogation, probable torture, certain public execution, having yet again to say my final goodbyes to the handful of people who still maintain a hold on my heart. The prospect of facing my mother, who will now be entirely alone in the world, decides it.
Good night, I whisper to the bow in my hand, and feel it go still. I raise my left arm and twist my neck down to rip off the pill on my sleeve. Instead, my teeth sink into flesh. I yank my head back in confusion to find myself looking into Peter's eyes, only now they hold my gaze. Blood runs from the teeth marks on the hand he clamped over my nightlock.
Let me go, I snarl at him, trying to wrest my arm from his grasp.
I can't, he says.
As they pull me away from him, I feel the pocket ripped from my sleeve, see the deep violet pill fall to the ground, watch Cinna's last gift get crunched under a guard's boot. I transform into a wild animal, kicking, clawing, biting, doing whatever I can to free myself from this web of hands as the crowd pushes in. The guards lift me up above the fray, where I continue to thrash as I'm conveyed over the crush of people. I start screaming for Gale. I can't find him in the throng, but he will know what I want. A good, clean shot to end it all. Only there's no arrow, no bullet. Is it possible he can't see me? No, above us, on the giant screens placed around the city circle, everyone can watch the whole thing being played out. He sees, he knows, but he doesn't follow through, just as I didn't when he was captured. Sorry excuses for hunters and friends, both of us. I'm on my own. In the mansion, they handcuff and blindfold me. I'm half-dragged, half-carried down long passages, up and down elevators, and deposited on a carpeted floor. The cuffs are removed and a door slams closed behind me. When I push the blindfold up, I find I'm in my old room at the training center. The one where I lived on those last precious days before my first Hunger Games and the Quarter Quell. The bed stripped to the mattress, the closet gates open, showing the emptiness inside. But I'd know this room anywhere. It's a struggle to get to my feet and peel off my Mockingjay suit. I'm badly bruised and might have a broken finger or two, but it's my skin that's paid most dearly for my struggle with the guards. The new pink stuff has shredded like tissue paper, and blood seeps through the laboratory-grown cells. No medics show up, though, and as I'm too far gone to care, I crawl up onto the mattress, expecting to bleed to death. No such luck. By evening, the blood clots, leaving me stiff and sore, and sticky, but alive. I limp into the shower and program in the gentlest cycle I can remember, free of any soaps and hair products, and squat under the warm spray, elbows on my knees, head in my hands. My name is Katniss Everdeen. Why am I not dead? I should be dead. It would be best for everyone if I were dead. When I step out on the mat, the hot air bakes my damaged skin dry. There's nothing clean to put on, not even a towel to wrap around me. Back in the room, I find the Mockingjay suit has disappeared. In its place is a paper robe. A meal has been sent up from the mysterious kitchen with a container of my medications for dessert. I go ahead and eat the food, take the pills, rub the salve on my skin. I need to focus now on the manner of my suicide. I curl back up on the blood-stained mattress, not cold, but feeling so naked, with just the paper to cover my tender flesh. Jumping to my death's not an option. The window glass must be a foot thick. I can make an excellent noose, but there's nothing to hang myself from. It's possible I could hoard my pills and then knock myself off with a lethal dose, except that I'm sure I'm being watched round the clock. For all I know, I'm on live television at this very moment, while commentators try to analyze what could possibly have motivated me to kill Coyne. The surveillance makes almost any suicide attempt impossible. Taking my life is the capital's privilege. Again. What I can do is give up. I resolve to lie on the bed without eating, drinking, or taking my medications. I could do it, too. Just die. If it weren't for the morphling withdrawal. Not bit by bit like in the hospital in 13, but cold turkey. I must have been on a fairly large dose, because when the craving for it hits, accompanied by tremors and shooting pains and unbearable cold, My resolve's crushed like an eggshell. I'm on my knees, raking the carpet with my fingernails to find those precious pills I flung away in a stronger moment. I revise my suicide plan to slow death by morphling. I will become a yellow-skinned bag of bones with enormous eyes. I'm a couple of days into the plan, making good progress, when something unexpected happens. I begin to sing, at the window, in the shower, in my sleep, hour after hour of ballads, love songs, mountain airs, all the songs my father taught me before he died, for certainly there has been very little music in my life since. What's amazing is how clearly I remember them, the tunes, the lyrics. My voice, at first rough and breaking on the high notes, warms up into something splendid, a voice that would make the mockingjays fall silent and then tumble over themselves to join in. Days pass, weeks. I watch the snow fall on the ledge outside my window, and in all that time, mine is the only voice I hear. What are they doing anyway? What's the hold-up out there? How difficult can it be to arrange the execution of one murderous girl? I continue with my own annihilation. My body's thinner than it's ever been, and my battle against hunger is so fierce that sometimes the animal part of me gives in to the temptation of buttered bread or roasted meat. But still, I'm winning. For a few days I feel quite unwell, and think I may finally be traveling out of this life when I realize my morphling tablets are shrinking. They are trying to slowly wean me off the stuff. But why? Surely a drugged mockingjay will be easier to dispose of in front of a crowd. And then a terrible thought hits me. What if they're not going to kill me? What if they have more plans for me? A new way to remake, train, and use me. I won't do it. If I can't kill myself in this room, I will take the first opportunity outside of it to finish the job. They can fatten me up. They can give me a full body polish, dress me up, and make me beautiful again. They can design dream weapons that come to life in my hands, but they will never again brainwash me into the necessity of using them. I no longer feel any allegiance to these monsters called human beings. Despise being one myself. I think that Peter was onto something about us destroying one another and letting some decent species take over. Because something is significantly wrong with a creature that sacrifices its children's lives to settle its differences. You can spin it any way you like. Snow thought the Hunger Games were an efficient means of control. Coin thought the parachutes would expedite the war. But in the end, who does it benefit? No one. The truth is, it benefits no one to live in a world where these things happen. After 2 days of my lying on my mattress with no attempt to eat, drink, or even take a morphling tablet, the door to my room opens. Someone crosses around the bed into my field of vision. Haymitch.
Your trial's over, he says. Come on. We're going home.
Home? What's he talking about? My home's gone. And even if it were possible to go to this imaginary place, I'm too weak to move. Strangers appear, rehydrate and feed me. Bathe and clothe me. One lifts me like a rag doll and carries me up to the roof, onto a hovercraft, and fastens me into a seat. Haymitch and Plutarch sit across from me. In a few moments we're airborne. I've never seen Plutarch in such a good mood. He's positively glowing.
You must have a million questions.
When I don't respond, he answers them anyway. After I shot Coin, there was pandemonium. When the ruckus died down, they discovered Snow's body, still tethered to the post. Opinions differ on whether he choked to death while laughing or was crushed by the crowd.
No one really cares. An emergency election was thrown together, and Paler was voted in as president. Plutarch was appointed Secretary of Communications, which means he sets the programming for the airwaves. The first big televised event was my trial, in which he was also a star witness. In my defense, of course. Although most of the credit for my exoneration must be given to Dr. Aurelius, who apparently earned his naps by presenting me as a hopeless, shell-shocked lunatic. One condition for my release is that I'll continue under his care, although it will have to be by phone, because he'd never live in a forsaken place like 12, and I'm confined there until further notice. The truth is, no one quite knows what to do with me now that the war's over, although if another one should spring up, Plutarch's sure they could find a role for me. Then Plutarch has a good laugh. It never seems to bother him when no one else appreciates his jokes. Are you preparing for another war, Plutarch? I ask.
Oh, not now. Now we're in that sweet period where everyone agrees that our recent horrors should never be repeated, he says. But collective thinking is usually short-lived. We are fickle, stupid beings with poor memories and a great gift for self-destruction. Although, who knows? Maybe this will be it, Katniss.
What? I ask.
The time it sticks. Maybe we are witnessing the evolution of the human race. Think about that.
And then he asks me if I'd like to perform on a new singing program he's launching in a few weeks. Something upbeat would be good. He'll send the crew to my house. We land briefly in District 3 to drop off Plutarch. He's meeting with Beatty to update the technology on the broadcast system. His parting words to me are, "Don't be a stranger!" When we're back among the clouds, I look at Haymitch.
So why are you going back to 12?
They can't seem to find a place for me in the capital either, he says.
At first, I don't question this, but doubts begin to creep in. Haymitch hasn't assassinated anyone. He could go anywhere. If he's coming back to 12, it's because he's been ordered to. You have to look after me, don't you? As my mentor.
He shrugs. Then I realize what it means.
My mother's not coming back.
No, he says.
He pulls an envelope from his jacket pocket and hands it to me. I examine the delicate, perfectly formed writing.
She's helping to start up a hospital in District 4. She wants you to call as soon as we get in.
My finger traces the graceful swoop of the letters.
You know why she can't come back.
Yes, I know why. Because between my father and Prim and the ashes, the place is too painful to bear, but apparently not for me.
Do you want to know who else won't be there?
No, I say.
I want to be surprised.
Like a good mentor, Haymitch makes me eat a sandwich and then pretends he believes I'm asleep for the rest of the trip. He busies himself going through every compartment on the hovercraft, finding the liquor and stowing it in his bag. It's night when we land on the green of the Victor's village. Half of the houses have lights in the windows, including Haymitch's and mine. Not Peter's. Someone has built a fire in my kitchen. I sit in the rocker before it, clutching my mother's letter.
Well, see you tomorrow, says Haymitch.
As the clinking of his bag of liquor bottles fades away, I whisper,
I doubt it.
I'm unable to move from the chair. The rest of the house looms cold and empty and dark. I pull an old shawl over my body and watch the flames. I guess I sleep, because the next thing I know it's morning and Greasy Say's banging around at the stove. She makes me eggs and toast and sits there until I've eaten it all. We don't talk much,
Her little granddaughter, the one who lives in her own world, takes a bright blue ball of yarn from my mother's knitting basket. Greasy Say tells her to put it back, but I say she can have it. No one in this house can knit any more. After breakfast, Greasy Say does the dishes and leaves, but she comes back up at dinner time to make me eat again. I don't know if she's just being neighborly or if she's on the government's payroll, but she shows up twice every day. She cooks, I consume. I try to figure out my next move. There's no obstacle now to taking my life, but I seem to be waiting for something. Sometimes the phone rings and rings and rings, but I don't pick it up. Hamish never visits. Maybe he changed his mind and left, although I suspect he's just drunk. No one comes but Greasy Say and her granddaughter. After months of solitary confinement, they seem like a crowd. "Spring's in the air today. You ought to get out," she says. "Go hunting." I haven't left the house. I haven't even left the kitchen, except to go to the small bathroom a few steps off of it. I'm in the same clothes I left the Capitol in. What I do is sit by the fire, stare at the unopened letters piling up on the mantel. I don't have a bow. "Check down the hall," she says. After she leaves, I consider a trip down the hall, rule it out, but after several hours I go anyway, walking in silent sock feet so as not to awaken the ghosts. In the study, where I had my tea with President Snow, I find a box with my father's hunting jacket, our plant book, my parents' wedding photo, the spile Hamish sent in, and the locket Peter gave me in the clock arena. The two bows and a sheath of arrows Gale rescued on the night of the firebombing lie on the desk. I put on the hunting jacket and leave the rest of the stuff untouched. I fall asleep on the sofa in the formal living room. A terrible nightmare follows, where I'm lying at the bottom of a deep grave and every dead person I know by name comes by and throws a shovelful of ashes on me. It's quite a long dream, considering the list of people, and the deeper I'm buried, the harder it is to breathe. I try to call out, begging them to stop, but the ashes fill my mouth and nose, and I can't make any sound. Still, the shovel scrapes on and on and on. I wake with a start. Pale morning light comes around the edges of the shutters. The scraping of the shovel continues. Still half in the nightmare, I run down the hall, out the front door, and around the side of the house, because now I'm pretty sure I can scream at the dead. When I see him, I pull up short. His face is flushed from digging up the ground under the windows. In a wheelbarrow are five scraggly bushes. "You're back," I say. "Dr. Aurelius wouldn't let me leave the Capitol until yesterday," Peter says. "By the way, he said to tell you, he can't keep pretending he's treating you forever. You have to pick up the phone." He looks well, thin and covered with burn scars like me, but his eyes have lost that clouded, tortured look. He's frowning slightly, though, as he takes me in. I make a half-hearted effort to push my hair out of my eyes and realize it's matted into clumps. I feel defensive. "What are you doing?" "I went to the woods this morning and dug these up. For her," he says. "I thought we could plant them along the side of the house." I look at the bushes, the clods of dirt hanging from their roots, and catch my breath as the word rose registers. I'm about to yell vicious things at Peter when the full name comes to me. Not plain rose, but evening primrose, the flower my sister was named for. I give Peter a nod of assent and hurry back into the house, locking the door behind me. But the evil thing is inside, not out. Trembling with weakness and anxiety, I run up the stairs, My foot catches on the last step, and I crash onto the floor. I force myself to rise and enter my room. The smell's very faint, but still laces the air. It's there, the white rose among the dried flowers in the vase, shriveled and fragile, but holding on to that unnatural perfection cultivated in Snow's greenhouse. I grab the vase, stumble down to the kitchen, and throw its contents into the embers. A burst of blue flame envelops the rose and devours it. Fire beats roses again. I smash the vase on the floor for good measure. Back upstairs, I throw open the bedroom windows to clear out the rest of Snow's stench. But it still lingers on my clothes and in my pores. I strip, and flakes of skin the size of playing cards cling to the garments. Avoiding the mirror, I step into the shower and scrub the roses from my hair, my body, my mouth. Bright pink and tingling, I find something clean to wear. It takes half an hour to comb out my hair. Greasy Say unlocks the front door. While she makes breakfast, I feed the clothes I had shed to the fire. At her suggestion, I pare off my nails with a knife. Over the eggs, I ask her, "Where did Gale go?"
"District 2. Got some fancy job there. I see him now and again on the television," she says.
I dig around inside myself, trying to register anger, hatred, longing. I find only relief.
"I'm going hunting today," I say.
"Well, I wouldn't mind some fresh game at that," she answers.
I arm myself with a bow and arrows and head out, intending to exit 12 through the meadow. Near the square are teams of masked and gloved people with horse-drawn carts, sifting through what lay under the snow this winter, gathering remains. A cart's parked in front of the mayor's house. I recognize Tom, Gale's old crewmate, pausing a moment to wipe the sweat from his face with a rag. I remember seeing him in 13, but he must have come back. His greeting gives me the courage to ask, "Did they find anyone in there?"
"Whole family, and the two people who worked for them," Tom tells me.
Madge, quiet and kind and brave, the girl who gave me the pin that gave me a name. I swallow hard. Wonder if she'll be joining the cast of my nightmares tonight, shoveling the ashes into my mouth. I thought maybe since he was the mayor.
"I don't think being the mayor of 12 put the odds in his favor," says Tom.
I nod and keep moving, careful not to look in the back of the cart. All through the town and the scene, it's the same, the reaping of the dead. As I near the ruins of my old house, the road becomes thick with carts. The meadow's gone, or at least dramatically altered. A deep pit has been dug, and they're lining it with bones, a mass grave for my people. I skirt around the hole and enter the woods at my usual place. It doesn't matter, though. The fence isn't charged anymore, and has been propped up with long branches to keep out the predators. But old habits die hard. I think about going to the lake, but I'm so weak that I barely make it to my meeting place with Gale. I sit on the rock where Cressida filmed us, but it's too wide without his body beside me. Several times I close my eyes and count to 10, thinking that when I open them, he will have materialized without a sound, as he so often did. I have to remind myself that Gale's in too, with a fancy job, probably kissing another pair of lips. It is the old Katniss's favorite kind of day, early spring, the woods awakening after the long winter. But the spurt of energy that began with the primroses fades away. By the time I make it back to the fence, I'm so sick and dizzy. Tom has to give me a ride home in the dead people's cart, help me to the sofa in the living room, where I watch the dust motes spin in the thin shafts of afternoon light. My head snaps around at the hiss, but it takes a while to believe he's real. How could he have gotten here? I take in the claw marks from some wild animal, the back paw he holds slightly above the ground, the prominent bones in his face. He's come on foot, then, all the way from 13. Maybe they kicked him out, or maybe he just couldn't stand it there without her, so he came looking. It was a waste of a trip. She's not here, I tell him. Buttercup hisses again. She's not here. You can hiss all you like. You won't find Prim. At her name, he perks up, raises his flattened ears, begins to meow hopefully. Get out! He dodges the pillow I throw at him. Go away! There's nothing left for you here. I start to shake, furious with him. She's not coming back! She's never, ever coming back here again! I grab another pillow and get to my feet to improve my aim. Out of nowhere, the tears begin to pour down my cheeks. She's dead! I clutch my middle to dull the pain, sink down on my heels, rocking the pillow, crying. She's dead, you stupid cat! She's dead! A new sound, part crying, part singing, comes out of my body, giving voice to my despair. Buttercup begins to wail as well. No matter what I do, he won't go. He circles me, just out of reach, as wave after wave of sobs racks my body, until eventually I fall unconscious. But he must understand. He must know that the unthinkable has happened, and to survive will require previously unthinkable acts. Because hours later, when I come to in my bed, he's there in the moonlight, crouched beside me, yellow eyes alert, guarding me from the night. In the morning, he sits stoically as I clean the cuts. But digging the thorn from his paw brings on a round of those kitten mews. We both end up crying again, only this time we comfort each other. On the strength of this, I open the letter Haymitch gave me from my mother, dial the phone number, and weep with her as well. Peter, bearing a warm loaf of bread, shows up with greasy say. She makes us breakfast, and I feed all my bacon to Buttercup. Slowly, with many lost days, I come back to life. I try to follow Dr. Aurelius's advice, just going through the motions, amazed when one finally has meaning again. I tell him my idea about the book, and a large box of parchment sheets arrives on the next train from the capital. I got the idea from our family's plant book, the place where we recorded those things you cannot trust to memory. The page begins with the person's picture, a photo if we can find it, if not, a sketch or painting by Peter. Then, in my most careful handwriting, come all the details it would be a crime to forget. Lady licking Prim's cheek. My father's laugh, Peter's father with the cookies, the color of Finnick's eyes, what Cinna could do with a length of silk, Boggs reprogramming the hollow, Rue poised on her toes, arms slightly extended like a bird about to take flight. On and on. We seal the pages with salt water, and promises to live well to make their deaths count. Haymitch finally joins us, contributing 23 years of tributes he was forced to mentor. Additions become smaller, an old memory that surfaces, a late primrose preserved between the pages, strange bits of happiness, like the photo of Finnick and Annie's newborn son. We learn to keep busy again. Peter bakes, I hunt. Haymitch drinks until the liquor runs out, and then raises geese until the next train arrives. Fortunately, the geese can take pretty good care of themselves. We're not alone. A few hundred others return, because whatever has happened, this is our home. With the mines closed, they plow the ashes into the earth and plant food. Machines from the capital break ground for a new factory where we will make medicines. Although no one seeds it, the meadow turns green again. Peter and I grow back together. There are still moments when he clutches the back of a chair and hangs on until the flashbacks are over. I wake screaming from nightmares of mutts and lost children. But his arms are there to comfort me, and eventually his lips. On the night I feel that thing again, the hunger that overtook me on the beach, I know this would have happened anyway. But what I need to survive is not Gale's fire, kindled with rage and hatred. I have plenty of fire myself. What I need is the dandelion in the spring, the bright yellow that means rebirth instead of destruction, the promise that life can go on, no matter how bad our losses, that it can be good again, and only Peter can give me that. So after, when he whispers, "You love me, real or not real," I tell him, "Real." Epilogue. They play in the meadow, the dancing girl with the dark hair and blue eyes, the boy with blonde curls and gray eyes, struggling to keep up with her on his chubby toddler legs. It took 5, 10, 15 years for me to agree, but Peter wanted them so badly. When I first felt her stirring inside of me, I was consumed with a terror that felt as old as life itself. Only the joy of holding her in my arms could tame it. Carrying him was a little easier, but not much. The questions are just beginning. The arenas have been completely destroyed, the memorials built. There are no more Hunger Games, but they teach about them at school, and the girl knows we played a role in them. The boy will know in a few years. How can I tell them about that world without frightening them to death? My children, who take the words of the song for granted. Deep in a meadow, under the willow, a bed of grass, a soft green pillow. Lay down your head and close your sleepy eyes, and when again they open, the sun will rise. Here it's safe, here it's warm, here the daisies guard you from every harm. Here your dreams are sweet, and tomorrow brings them true. Here is the place where I love you. My children, who don't know, they play on a graveyard. Peter says it will be okay. We have each other and the book. We can make them understand in a way that will make them braver. But one day, I'll have to explain about my nightmares. Why they came, why they won't ever really go away. I'll tell them how I survive it. I'll tell them that on bad mornings, it feels impossible to take pleasure in anything because I'm afraid it could be taken away. That's when I make a list in my head of every act of goodness I've seen someone do. It's like a game. Repetitive, even a little tedious after more than 20 years. But there are much worse games to play. This is Carolyn McCormick. We hope you have enjoyed this production of Mockingjay by Suzanne Collins. This program was produced and directed by Robert Kessler, executive producer Paul R. Gagne. Original music by Robert Kessler and Rocco Cambereri. Text copyright 2010 by Suzanne Collins. Production copyright 2010, Scholastic Inc. All rights reserved.
Hi, I'm Suzanne Collins. The spark that inspired the Hunger Games trilogy? A significant influence would have to be the Greek myth of Theseus and the Minotaur. The myth tells how in punishment for past deeds, Athens periodically had to send 7 youths and 7 maidens to Crete, where they were thrown in the labyrinth and devoured by the monstrous Minotaur. Theseus, who was the son of the king, volunteered to go. I guess in her own way, Katniss is a futuristic Theseus. But she may even be more closely tied to the historical figure of Spartacus. He was a Roman slave and gladiator who lived in the 1st century BC. He broke out of his gladiator school in Capua, started an uprising, and that led to what is known as the Third Servile War. I send my tributes into an updated version of the Roman gladiator games. While the details are different, the 3 essential elements remain. 1, you have a ruthless government that 2, forces people to fight to the death as 3, a form of popular entertainment. The actual moment of inspiration for the trilogy came when I was channel surfing between reality TV programming and news coverage of the war in Iraq. One night, I'm sitting there flipping around on one channel. There's a group of young people competing for, I don't know, money. And on the next, there's a group of young people fighting in an actual war. And I was tired, and the lines began to blur in this very unsettling way, and I thought of Katniss's story. I never directly base any of my characters off real people. Since the situations that they'll be entering will be futuristic and specific to that time, but there are definitely bits and pieces of characters that were inspired by people in my own life. For instance, if you take the crew who create the Hunger Games each year, a lot of those personalities, their attitudes, their absorption with the show they're creating come from my work in television. I've been a television writer for over 19 years. In a way, it's very easy for me to imagine the world of the game makers because, in a much gentler way, I was one myself. What would I like young readers to ultimately take away from the Hunger Games trilogy? Questions about how elements of the book might be relevant in their own lives? Like, how do you feel about the fact that some people take their next meal for granted when so many other people are starving in the world? What do you think about choices your government, past and present, or other governments around the world make? What's your relationship to reality TV versus your relationship to the news? And was there anything in the book that disturbed you because it reflected aspects of your own life? And if there was, what can you do about it? I think it's important for everyone to read. It exposes you to people and places and times and ideas that you might never encounter or encounter in such an intimate way. There's this one-on-one connection. No one's interpreting the material for you. It's this opportunity for your mind to meet the writer's mind. Grab it.